Good evening, everyone. My name is Sheila Armstead, and I am one of the faculty members of the social work program here at IU East. About 5 years ago, I was on a trip with my two granddaughters. They went to Amsterdam, and while we were there, we visited a concentration camp, and we had the opportunity of going all the way through and reliving what a victim slash survivor went through on a daily basis. On our way back home, we talked about, would it be possible, it would be awesome if we could meet someone who was a survivor. And going through and doing some research, I found Eva Kor, and that she lived not too far from us. And I started inquiring as to whether or not we could possibly bring her here to campus. This has been a 2-year journey of getting her here. And it is my honor. I could talk all day long about her, but I'm not going to because I know you're waiting to hear her. But it is indeed my honor at this time to introduce to you Eva Kor. And while she is getting settled, what I would like, if all of the diversity committee members that are here, if they would stand and be recognized, because we have worked really, really hard to get Mrs. Kor here.
Okay. Since it took you 2 years to get all these people here, those who are standing, it would make me feel really good if you just came here and sat on stage, share the stage with me. Is that possible, fire marshals? Because there is plenty of room in here. You can sit here and somebody could even have a chair. Okay, I am going to remove that. Right? Isn't that better? You're close instead of up there and somewhere. There is plenty of room right here, and you can even get closer to me, let people sit there. Yeah. How about that?
That is fine, thank you.
Well, thank you very much for coming to my lecture. My name is Eva Kor. I am a survivor of Auschwitz, a survivor of medical experiments conducted by Dr. Mengele. And now that I've turned 82, I'm trying to survive old age. And I found out that it's a lot trickier than I thought it was. My lecture is divided in 3 parts. Part 1, how I survived Auschwitz. Part 2, the lessons that I have learned, and I will entertain a few questions, maybe 3 or 4, at the end of my presentation. It was the dawn of an early spring day in 1944. Our cattle car train came to a sudden stop. We were cooped in the cattle car for about 4 days, about 100 people. There was no room to sit. We were standing and leaning against one another. Among the 100 people was my father, Alexander Moses, age 44. My mother, Jaffa, age 38. My oldest sister, Edith, 14. My middle sister, Alice, 12. And Miriam and I, who were only 10 years old, twins. As soon as we stepped down from the cattle car onto a cement platform called the selection platform, because people were selected to live or to die. It is a little strip of cement. Now it's just land, it's still there, measuring 85 feet long by 35 feet wide. In my opinion, there is no other strip of land like that anywhere on the face of this earth, where millions of people were ripped apart from their families forever. So we stepped down. My mother grabbed my twin sister and me by the hand. We were her youngest children, and she hoped that as long as she could hold on to us, that she could protect us. Everything was moving very fast. In my childish curiosity, I looked around, trying to figure out what on earth is this place. And as I looked around, I realized that my father and two older sisters disappeared in the crowd. Never ever did I see them again. So now we are holding on to mother for dear life, and Nazi is running, yelling in German, "Twins." We did not volunteer any information. We had no idea what worked in this place. He noticed Miriam and me because we were dressed alike and we looked alike, and he demanded to know if we were twins. And my mother asked, "Is that good?" And the Nazi nodded yes, and my mother said yes. At that moment, another Nazi came, pulled my mother to the right, we were pulled to the left, we were crying, she was crying, and all I really remember is seeing my mother's arms stretched out in despair as she was pulled away. I never even got to say goodbye to her, and I didn't really understand that this would be the last time that we would see her. And all that took 30 minutes from the time we stepped down from the cattle car. Miriam and I no longer had a family. We were all alone, and we had no idea what would become of us. We became part of a group of little girls, all twins. In our group, there were 13 sets of female twins between the ages of 2 and 16, and one mother, whose name was Mrs. Changery, she had twins 3 years younger than we were, and she was my mother's friend. Our group was taken to a huge building for processing. We sat actually most of the day naked. Our processing began late in the afternoon. That meant that they cut our hair short. The mother's head was shaved. Our dresses were returned with a huge oil-painted red cross on the back. The mother was given striped prison uniform, and then they lined us up for registration and tattooing. When my turn came, I decided to give them as much trouble as a 10-year-old could. Now see the benefits coming up here close? You can see? Isn't that wonderful? So four people restrained me with all their strength while they heated a needle attached to a handle over the flame of a lamp. When the needle got hot, they dipped it into ink, and then they burned into my left arm, dot by dot, the capital letter A, dash, 7063. Miriam became capital A, dash, 7064. Auschwitz was the only Nazi camp that tattooed its inmates. My husband, who is a survivor of 4 years in Buchenwald, does not have a tattoo. And why they chose Auschwitz, I don't know. And when I compared notes with Miriam in 1985, she said that in addition to creating a general confusion, that I bit the Nazi holding my arm. Wouldn't you have done that? Well, I don't remember biting anybody. I was raised to be a nice girl. And as we know, nice girls and nice boys don't bite, right? So I must have blocked it out of my mind. Once we were processed, we were marched throughout the camp. We arrived at a wooden modular horse barn. Crude, filthy. I have never seen anything filthier in my life. The barrack was divided in two by a brick bench On each side of the brick bench, there was a walkway and then the three-story high bunk beds. Miriam and I were given a bunk bed on the bottom. We have not slept or stretched out in 4 days. So we thought that would be nice to maybe somehow sleep or at least stretch out. But human beings cannot function after such a traumatic day as we experienced, because I kept tossing and turning and I could not sleep, even though I was very, very tired. And as I was tossing and turning, I noticed something big and dark moving on the floor, and I began counting, and when I got to 5, I jumped up screaming. These were the biggest mice I have ever seen. So I began screaming, "Mice, mice!" And a girl from the top bunk said, "Silly kid, these are not mice, they are rats, and you better get used to them because they are everywhere." And they were. Now, because our bunk bed was on the bottom, we couldn't even try to go back to sleep. We went to the latrine. And as I entered the place, there on the filthy latrine floor were the scattered corpses of 3 children. I have never, ever seen anybody dead before. But to me, it became clear that in this place, children were dying. So right then and there, I made a silent pledge that I will do anything and everything within my power to make sure that Miriam and I shall not end up on that filthy latrine floor. From the moment we left the latrine, I did everything instinctively. Instinctively means, for your information, if you accidentally put your hand in a pot of hot water, what will you do? Pull it out, right? Nobody has to teach you to do that. And in the camp, you learned what was safe and what wasn't. I even had an image in my mind that Miriam and how Miriam and I might look when we walked out of this camp alive. And I never let go of that image until the day we were liberated. We would be awakened every morning at 5 a.m. By 6 a.m., we were outside for roll call, summer, winter, rain, or shine. And I can tell you that by the time the winter of 1944-45 rolled around, my dress was filled with holes and so were my shoes. We did not get any winter coats or winter clothes. I do not know. I was back in Auschwitz January of last year, 2015, and I wore UGG boots, 2 layers of clothes, wool coat, and I was still cold. And people asked me, how on earth did you survive 70 years ago? I don't understand it, but that is the way it was. After roll call, we would go back to the barrack for Dr. Joseph Mengele's daily inspection, and he wanted to count us. Every day he would come in except on Sunday, and that is the way we knew it was Sunday. Instead of going into the whole routine, I will kind of give you a general description. I wanted to realize or imagine little children, girls, between the ages of 2 and 16. We were huddling in our filthy bunk beds, crawling with lice and rats. We were starved for food. Starvation in Auschwitz was a very big problem. I would say probably the calories that the food we got had no more than 300 calories a day. And the only edible food we got at night, that was about a 2.5-inch very dark bread. We were starved for human kindness, and we were starved for the love of the mothers and fathers we once had. We had no rights. We had a fierce determination, and all we could think was how to live one more day, how to survive one more experiment. I was used in two types of experiments. After the brownish liquid that they gave us for breakfast was given, we would be taken on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday to a huge building, about 50 sets of twins. Always they would remove our clothes and we would sit or stand, or alternative, sometimes sit, sometimes stand, for 8 hours a day. They would measure just about every part of my body, compare it to my twin sister, and compare it to charts. These experiments were not dangerous, but they were unbelievably demeaning. How would any of you cope if you would have to stand or sit naked for 8 hours a day in order to live one more day? The only way that I could cope with it is by blocking it out of my mind. On alternate days, on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, we would be taken to another lab that I call the blood lab, because they would tie both of my arms to restrict the blood flow. They would take a lot of blood from my left arm and give me a minimum of 5 injections into my right arm. The content of those injections we didn't know then. The rumor was that they were germs, diseases, and drugs, and that's probably correct. After one of those injections, I became very ill with a very high fever. In fact, I tried to hide, because the rumor in the camp was that anyone taken to the hospital never came back. Well, next visit to the blood lab, instead of measuring my, tying my arms for blood taking, they measured my fever, and I knew I was in trouble. I knew I had a very high fever because I was trembling as the August sun was burning my skin. Both my legs and arms were swollen and very painful, and I had huge red spots throughout my body. So I was taken to the hospital, which was another barrack, but this barrack was filled with people who looked, to me, they looked more dead than alive. Next morning, Dr. Mengele came in with 4 other doctors. He never ever examined me. He looked at my fever chart and then he declared, laughing sarcastically. He said, "Too bad, she's so young, but she has only 2 weeks to live." I knew he was right, but I refused to accept his verdict. I decided to prove him wrong. I made a second silent pledge that I will do everything within my power to prove Mengele wrong, to survive and be reunited with my sister. For the following 2 weeks, I have only one clear memory. I remember crawling on the barrack floor because I no longer could walk, and I was crawling to reach a faucet at the other end of the barrack, because this barrack was not even allocated water. People were brought there to die. And as I was crawling, I would fade in and out of consciousness. And even in a semi-conscious state of mind, I kept telling myself, I must survive. I must survive. After 2 weeks, my fever broke, and I immediately felt a lot stronger and a lot better. And it took me another 3 weeks before my fever chart showed normal, and I was released and reunited with my twin sister and the other twins. But Miriam looked very sick. She looked just like the living dead I left in the barrack. And I asked her, "What have they done to you?" She said, "I cannot talk about it. I will not talk about it." And Miriam and I never talked about Auschwitz until 1985. That's a long time. And I wondered about that. And I, in my understanding, is that children who fight to survive, cannot talk about it until they feel physically safe, even as grown-ups. And that did not happen for us until 1985. The second problem for most survivors of trauma is that they are afraid that they are going to fall apart. And no survivor of tragedy wants to fall apart. In my experience has been that I only remembered as much as I could cope with. It didn't come. It little by little by little, I remembered more and more. So in 1985, when I talked to her, I asked her, I said, Miriam, do you remember when I was taken to the hospital? She said, yes. I said, well, what happened to you? Well, I was in the hospital because there are no books written about our experiments. She said, well, for the first 2 weeks, after you were taken away, I was kept in isolation, and lots of doctors were studying me continuously, and they were waiting for something to happen. They did not tell me what that was, and I don't know if it happened or it didn't happen. But it was the same 2 weeks that Mengele said I would die. From the Auschwitz Museum, I have learned, would I have died? Miriam would have been rushed to Mengele's lab, killed with an injection to the heart. And then Mengele would have done the comparative autopsies. My diseased organs, and Miriam was the control. In Auschwitz, Mengele used 1,500 sets of twins, which means 3,000 individuals. According to the best information that we have, there are no more than 250 individuals who survived. So the majority of the twins died in the experiment. In normal life, you cannot take a set of twins, inject one with a deadly germ. When that one dies, you kill the other one and you see how the germs work. But in Auschwitz, everything was possible. So I asked Miriam, what happened to you, Miriam, after the 2 weeks were up? She said, I was taken back to the labs, injected with many injections that made me feel very sick. Well, we were liberated on January 27, 1945. After liberation, we were in refugee camps for about 9 months, and we arrived back in Romania to our village and home in October of 1945. There was no one who returned, and all I could find in our home, there were 3 crumbled pictures on a bedroom floor, and that was all that was left of my family. In end, my father's youngest sister, who lived in a big city, survived, and she took us in. She married a guy who lost his family, so we were that strange, mixed-up family. Unfortunately, a year after I got back, end of 1946, Romania became a communist country. One flag was pulled down, one flag was pulled up. So I watched as a 11-year-old what was going on, or 12-year-old, and they had tremendously beautiful slogans. Brotherhood, equality, freedom. Wow, I wanted freedom, brotherhood, and equality, so I got involved in school in the Youth Communist Party. I became a president, and I was the leader of 30 little pioneers. Well, 1948, I was told that I needed to take my pioneers to a May Day parade in the morning, which I did. At noon, we had a picnic in the park, and then they told me to take my troop to a torch parade. I saw too much parading. I needed to study, and these little kids also had to study for a test next day, so I sent everybody home. Next day, I was called into headquarters, and the director of the youth program said, where were you with your pioneers last night? I said that I thought it was more important to study than to go to one more parade. He said, when you are in the Communist Party, you are not supposed to think. You are supposed to follow orders. Is that clear to you? So to myself, I'm a survivor of Auschwitz. What can they do to me? So I said, okay, then I don't like your party. I didn't know it was that serious, see? I don't like your party, I just want to get out of the party. Oh, he said, we are going to kick you out of the party. I was 14 years old. But there is no school in Romania you can attend. And at age 14, I saw that I still needed to study. I remained in the party, but my aunt said to me, Eva, if anybody ever gets in trouble, it's always you. So we applied for a visa to Israel. It took us 2 years to get our visa. Actually, Israel was willing to give us an entry visa. Romania was not willing to give us an exit visa. So we arrived in Romania. We were traveling on a ship. They would not permit us to take anything except the clothes on our back. So I wore 3 dresses and a winter coat. Well, that was the first coat I had since we have been in the camp. And I stood in line with Miriam for 20 hours to somehow get that coat, and I was not going to leave it in Romania. In Israel, we were sent to an agricultural school where there were children orphaned by the war from 30 countries. We went to school 4 hours a day, and we worked in the fields 4 hours a day. In 1952, we turned 18 years old, and we were drafted into the Israeli army. Miriam was sent to medical corps. She studied and became a registered nurse. I was sent to engineering corps. I studied and became a draftsman. I stayed in the Israeli army 8 years, reaching the rank of sergeant major. I had a pretty good life. I was stationed in Tel Aviv. In 1960, I met a tourist from Terre Haute, Indiana, who has been in, people usually make the mistake saying that we met in Israel, we got married in Israel, and then we made our way to United States. Incorrect. My husband has lived in Terre Haute, Indiana, since 1946. He was liberated by an American lieutenant colonel by the name of Andrew Neff, who was from Terre Haute, Indiana. And when the war ended, my husband said, I like you Americans, you are very nice. And so I would like to go to America. Will you help me go to America? And they did. So he never ever wanted to live anywhere else but in Terre Haute, Indiana. So yeah, that's a fact. So when I married him in Tel Aviv, I came from Tel Aviv to Terre Haute. That's a pretty big jump, I will tell you that much. Miriam got married 2 years earlier in 1958. She married an Israeli. And she expected her first baby in 1960. She developed severe kidney infections that did not respond to any antibiotic. Second pregnancy in 1963, the infection of her kidneys got worse, and this is when the Israeli doctor studied her and they found out that Miriam's kidneys never grew larger than the size of a 10-year-old child. What we are assuming, we don't know because we don't have our records, that when I didn't die, Mengele decided to use my sister for another experiment and injected her with something that stunted the growth of her kidneys. I told Miriam, you have 2 children, that's pretty good. Don't have any more children. every pregnancy is a life crisis. But she didn't listen to me. I was right. Unfortunately, I was right. She had a third child 8 years later, and she barely survived the pregnancy, and after the pregnancy, her kidneys started to deteriorate very fast, and nothing seemed to help. By 1987, her kidneys failed, at which time she had two choices, to go on dialysis or have a kidney transplant. Well, she put her name on a kidney transplant, and I had a very difficult year in 1987. My son was diagnosed in May with advanced case of testicular cancer that metastasized in his lungs and in his lymph nodes. So, and I got a letter from Miriam that she put her name on a kidney transplant, kidney donation list. So I told her the following, that I will undergo all the studies necessary to become a donor, and as soon as my son was out of any danger, I will go to Israel and donate one of my kidneys, and that's what I did. And my son is alive and lives in Baltimore, Maryland. But we were a perfect match, and at that hospital near Tel Aviv, they have been doing kidney transplants for 10 years, and they had 2,000 survivors. All of them were given anti-rejection medication. None of them developed cancerous polyps in the bladder like Miriam did a year later. And the doctors were very puzzled because they have been doing these transplants for years. They kept asking me, like, I had all the answers. Could you find? Well, that's the way people sometimes act toward me. I am not. If I could find our Auschwitz files, that they could maybe figure out what was injected into Miriam and help her with another anti-rejection medication. We never found our files. We never found out what was injected into our body. Miriam died June 6, 1993. I will take you back to the camp because I want to share with you some other experiences. Particularly, I want to share with you the fact how children function at age 10 in a camp. I want you to realize that children function completely differently than teenagers and grown-ups. They... Okay. There goes modern technology. All right. Oh, it's very handy, so we are not disturbed very long. It takes a lot of energy for children to function in the here and now. And I will ask you here a question. There are quite a few young children. How many of you are under age 13? Raise your hands. We have quite a group. How many of you nagged your parents asking them, when do we get there? Raise your hands. Some of you might have been, but it is not unusual for young children to nag the grown-ups, when do we get there? Do you know why that is? Children cannot project forward, cannot project backward. It takes a lot of energy for the child to function in the here and now. So as a 10-year-old, I thought that is the way the world was. Everybody in the world lived in miserable conditions like I did, starving to death without any family. And nothing really changed that idea until August, end of August of 1944. An airplane appeared over the skies of Auschwitz. It was flying very low. I could see the American flag. on one of the wings. That gave me hope that somebody was trying to free us. Besides that, to me, everything was military zone. There was no person, civilian, that I ever saw until shortly before liberation. But actually, I saw that that is the way the world was. That gave me hope that somebody was trying to free us. And really, hope in Auschwitz was in very short supply. The air raids continued and greatly increased. And by end of November, it felt like a continuous battlefield. I could feel it in every ounce of my being that this cannot last much longer. All the experiments were stopped, and we, the children, developed a slogan: someday soon, we will be free and we will go home. But we had no idea how freedom would happen. The air raids continued and greatly increased until January 27, when one morning we woke up and it was quiet, very eerily quiet. And we wondered, what does it mean? Is this the day we are going to be free? A woman ran into the barrack late afternoon of January 27, yelling at the top of her voice, "We are free! We are free!" Wonderful. I thought, shouldn't there be some other sign besides this woman running in? So we went outside to see if we could see something. It was snowing so heavily, I couldn't see anything. I was there maybe 30 minutes until my eyes got used to the poor visibility, when at a distance I could see lots of people. They were all smiling from ear to ear. They were wrapped in white camouflage raincoats. I had no idea who they were, but one thing was important to me. They didn't look like the Nazis. We ran up to them. They gave us chocolate, cookies, and hugs. And this was my first taste of freedom, for me to realize that Miriam and I were alive, that my little promise to myself that first night in the latrine became a reality. And that was an unbelievable experience. I want to thank you all for making the effort and coming to hear me. Today's lecture is lecture number 10 this year. Well, last year I gave 203. I don't think I will do that many this year. But I tell you about that because I want you to realize that I talk a lot, right? I talk a lot, and I want to thank you, little ones, very young ones. That is a long, this lady speaks a lot, right? So why do I speak so much? I have learned some very important lessons from my life that I want to share them with you, because I think you might be able to use them. Life lesson number one: never ever give up on yourself or on your dreams. And as I look at your young faces, I remember, growing up is very hard. It's very hard even if you have loving parents, but that would be a very good beginning for every child born in this world. And even if your loving parents are wealthy enough to buy you designer jeans with holes in them. I know, I don't understand it, but I am very old-fashioned. And even if your parents are wealthy enough to buy you all the modern gadget, iPhone, etc., even then, every single one of you want to figure out, how on earth do I fit into this big, big mixed up world? Will I be able to accomplish in life what I set out to do? I can tell you one thing. if you give up, nothing will happen. On the other hand, I guarantee to every single one of you, if you keep hammering away at it, it is your wonderful minds that will come up with answers that will work. I had no idea how to survive Auschwitz. I tried different things, and here I am, 71 years later, very happy to be alive. I want you to remember that there is always hope after despair, and there is always a tomorrow after disaster. And if you don't give up on yourselves and on your dreams, you can accomplish anything you put your mind to. I think the biggest poverty in the world, in my opinion, is not economic poverty, but emotional poverty. People told me, first time I proved somebody wrong, when Mengele said I wouldn't survive, I proved him wrong. And today, if anybody tell me, oh, you don't have this college degree, you cannot do that, I said, I am going to prove you wrong. You don't know. You just gave me the right thing because I am going to prove you wrong. So, if anybody tells you, tries to discourage you that you cannot do it, prove them wrong. That should be your slogan, because no accomplishment is ever easy. But if you won't do anything, you're just going to sit in a corner and feel sorry for yourself. That is not going to make you happy. I, Eva Kor, want to be the best Eva Kor I can be. And what I challenge every single one of you to make sure that you become the best you that you can be. When you are the best you, you are a happy person. You are an asset to your community. People love you. You have friends. Everything is working fine. On the other hand, if you are the worst that you can be, you are a miserable person. But you have the choice. Even here, after I have had both of my hips replaced, I travel throughout the world with my walker, and my fellow survivors said, even in the walker you're going? I said, yeah, so it's a little bit more dramatic appearance, but but I can still speak. I am not going to do any acrobatics. So life lesson one is very, very important. Life lesson number two deals with prejudice. Prejudice was one of the reasons that Hitler was successful in rising to power. And you know, he hated me. I never met him. I thought I was a cute little girl. Why did he hate me? Prejudice always hurts the victims. But it also destroys people and societies that permit it. Other reason that Hitler rose to power, and we should be aware of that, is because of the bad economy. Bad economies, in my opinion, are the seeds for genocide. I talked to people, survivors from Darfur and Rwanda, and the same thing happened, bad economy, and then some bad leaders rose to power and they pinned one group of people against the other using the prejudices in these countries. So I don't think people realize how easy it is to, for you young people, prejudice means prejudging people without knowing them. And it hurts, always hurts, and societies will be destroyed. Well, as I sit here, I want to confess to the fact that I am prejudiced, not against any race, religion, or ethnic group. I am prejudiced against the sloppiness, the sloppy clothes, and the styles of clothing that young people were, particularly in school, but you are most of your college students. But when I go to a classroom, let me tell you what I see there. All the colors of the rainbow, very low cut blouses. Every girl wants to look sexy. Even they flaunt what they have or they wish they had, I don't know. Then of course, if they wear very short and they bend down, the tush is sticking out. That is tantalizing, all these things. I don't like the styles of long hair, and I know this is a style because it's flying in the wind. I know you all want to look sexy. I think, in my opinion, I mean, we have people like Madonna, Beyonce, Miley Cyrus, who are flaunting every part of their body. And if I ever could get to talk to one of them, I would tell them that they ought to be ashamed of themselves. They are good looking, they are famous, they are rich, they are talented, but they don't know that they are serving as a role model to young girls in the world. And I think they could do a much better job, but they don't care. So anyway, if I ever get the opportunity, I hope you're there to hear what I'm going to say. So this is where most of the young people and mature people get their ideas. Hollywood. If I ever go to Hollywood, I am going to wear what I think people should. Don't flaunt all these body parts. I mean, I see some of these movie stars, even older ones, flaunt quite a lot, and the styles are ridiculous. After you turn 50, you don't want to show your body because they wear low-cut blouses, and the skin is hanging, the chin, the double chin, oh gosh, that is old age I'm trying to deal with. So I am covering everything up. You're never going to. I don't like body piercing. I know that's another crazy style. Tattoos. Now, have you ever asked yourself, those of you who are worshiping tattoos, is that really good for the skin to have that ink inside? I don't think if you consulted a doctor or an expert that they would advise you that that's good for good health. But that's what's happening. And then the unbelievably ugly baggy pants. I had a group visiting the museum, and in the front row was a kid with baggy pants. And I said, okay, please tell me, why do you wear baggy pants? He said, they are very comfortable. I said, try a skirt. He did not appreciate my humor. About 17 years ago, I was asked to lecture at a local high school. I'm heading to the auditorium in Terre Haute, and in front of me are three 16-year-old boys with very baggy pants. The crotch was the height of the knee. They were holding their pants up with a hand, the bottoms, they're cleaning the hallway. As I was walking behind them, when one of them dropped a book, and he had the audacity to bend down and pick it up. I saw places where the sun never shined. I was really, really embarrassed. I have never seen that before. But then I realized this school is supported by my tax money. And then I got really upset. I went up to the teacher who invited me and told him what happened, and I pointed to the three young men. And I've been lecturing by that time 21 years. I'm lecturing now 37, 38. And I told him that they looked like bombs because they don't look very sharp. I look at the guys with baggy pants, they don't look little sharp. And why would anybody want to look like a bomb? I said, maybe they were all drug addicts. And then the teacher said to me the most amazing thing, that these three boys were very good students and they have never, ever used any drugs. I was shocked. But what I realized that even that I don't like these the way they look, even then I have to take the time to get to know them before I pass any judgment on them. So I have been trying to keep that image in my mind, but I will never like these styles of clothing. That's it. Life lesson number three. I have forgiven the Nazis. I have forgiven everybody. Could you forgive people who have murdered your family and who were out to kill you? Of course, most people say no. Can you change what happened? Do you know, no matter what I would try to do, I could not change what the Nazis did. And if anybody would have asked me 23 years ago today, if I was going to forgive the Nazis, I would have told you, find a really good psychiatrist and have your head examined, because you must be crazy. I was a very good victim. And what does that mean? I was very angry with the world, and I hated everybody. And nothing changed until Miriam died. And what really happened was amazing. I came home with all these evolving things. I came home on a Sunday afternoon, June 6, 1993. There was a message on my answering machine from my brother-in-law telling me, I am sorry to inform you, but your sister died. I immediately called Israel, told my brother-in-law that I would catch the first flight that I could find, and I wanted to bury my sister. I have never buried any member of my family. I just had to accept that over 100 members of my family, that included 10 brothers and sisters of my father, from the 13 only three survived, and their wives and their children and grandparents, and they were direct uncles, aunts, and cousins and grandparents who died. I just had to accept it that they were dead. So I wanted to actually touch my sister to verify that she was dead. I wanted to say goodbye to her. And I wanted to say goodbye to my kidney she was taking with her. But my brother-in-law said, we can't wait for you. The funeral is in 10 hours. Israel is 7 hours ahead. There is no way you can make it. And actually, the flight from United States to Israel takes 10 hours. And on the way back, because I just came back from Israel mid-January, 12 hours in the air. So I was left with a lot of pain, and I would wake up many nights suffocating. Because that is the way Miriam died. Her lungs were filled with cancer and she suffocated. And twins have a way of experiencing what the other twin experienced. Then I couldn't go back to sleep. And that went on for quite some time. I knew that eventually I would do something in her memory, because that is my way of coping with pain. And 2 years after her death, I opened Kendall's Holocaust Museum, and my nightmares stopped. 1 month after Miriam died, unrelated to her death, I received a telephone call from a professor at Boston College who told me, Eva, I have heard you speak. I am doing a conference on Nazi medicine, and I would like you to come to Boston. And by the way, he said, when you come to Boston, it would be really, really nice if you could bring with you a Nazi doctor. Stunned at such a request, I blurted out, where on earth do you think I could find one of those guys? Last time I looked, they are not advertising in the yellow pages. So he said to me, okay, Eva, think about it. Maybe you come up with some ideas. And I remembered the last project that Miriam and I worked on was in 1992, was a documentary done by German television of the Mengele twins. And we finished it March 1992. And in that documentary, when I got a copy of it, there was a Nazi doctor from Auschwitz. His name was Hans Munch. He was not my doctor, but I understood from the film that he was a friend of Joseph Mengele's. I immediately contacted the television station in Frankfurt, told them that Miriam died, and would they please give me Dr. Munch's telephone number in the memory of Miriam. I tried to get Dr. Munch's telephone number in 1992 when the documentary came out. They refused to give it to me. But now, immediately they faxed me a letter back with Dr. Munch's telephone number. We contacted Dr. Munch, invited him to Boston. He said to me, I am not going to Boston, but I will meet with you at my house and I will give you a videotaped interview you can take to Boston. So, August 20, 1993, I am heading to Germany to meet a Nazi doctor. You have no idea how scared I was. Suddenly, every nerve in my body was rebelling against my actions. What I remembered about Nazi doctors, I did not want to experience again, but I was also curious. Why was this Nazi doctor willing to meet with me? And maybe because he was a friend of Mengele's, he knew something about our experiments. We arrived at his house with two camera crews and some friends. He treated me with the utmost respect, kindness, and consideration. But he told me he knew nothing about our experiments because Mengele always told him that the twins' experiments were top secret. He gave me a good report on what he did in Auschwitz, and we were sitting outside, and he made me feel comfortable. Suddenly a thought popped into my head, and I heard myself say, Dr. Munch, by any chance, do you know anything about the operation of the gas chamber in Auschwitz? And he immediately said, this is my problem. This is a nightmare that I live with every single day of my life, and went on describing the operation of the gas chamber. People would be told that they are going to take a shower. The shower room was cleaned and polished. They would even spread perfume. Once the shower room was packed with people, the doors closed hermetically. Dr. Munch was stationed outside looking through a peephole. The gas did not come from the shower heads. If you Google Zyklon B, you will find it's a pellet of white gravel that was put in canisters, stored in canisters. The canisters were opened outside the roof and dropped in holes, openings like vents, and they dropped to the floor. It operated like dry ice. So the gas was actually rising from the floor of the shower room, and as people were hit by it and had difficulty breathing, they would climb. Usually the last breath of air they did, they climbed on somebody else, trying to get away from the rising gas, forming a little mountain of intermingled bodies. Dr. Munch looked from the outside. When the people on the top of that pile stopped moving, he knew that everybody was dead, and he would sign one death certificate. No names, just the number of people that were murdered. I have never ever heard about that before. I have been studying, grabbing anything about the Holocaust and Auschwitz. I have read books written by Sonderkommando. There was never any. They did their thing, but maybe they didn't know that Dr. Munch signed a death certificate or other doctors. So I said to him, this is important information. I am going to Auschwitz in 1995. I want you to go with me and sign a document at the ruins of the gas chamber in the company of witnesses. So nobody could say years later you didn't sign that document, just what you told me. And he immediately said to me, I would love to. I didn't know it was going to be that easy. I got back to Terre Haute, Indiana, very excited that I will have an original document signed by a Nazi. So if I ever meet people who say the Holocaust didn't happen, I can say that document and kind of shove it in their face. But I cannot even today understand it. I felt a strong need to thank this Nazi doctor. I didn't want to tell anybody about it because it sounded strange even to me. Now, how on earth do you thank a Nazi doctor? Where does one look for a gift for a Nazi doctor? I didn't know. So I went to the local Hallmark shop and I went to the section of thank you cards. And I began reading card after card after card for 2.5 hours. I was very serious. Two ladies came up to me. You've been reading those cards for a long time. I said, yes. Are you finding what you are looking for? I said, not really. Well, what are you looking for? We can help you find it. I said, no, thank you very much. I left the card shop, but I could not give up my idea. I needed to find something meaningful for Dr. Munch as a gesture of my thanks. So I went back to my own life lesson number one. For the next 10 months, while I was cooking, cleaning, doing the laundry, driving the car, I brainstormed with a simple question. How can I thank Dr. Munch? What can I give Dr. Munch? And 10 months later, a simple idea popped into my head. How about a letter of forgiveness from me to Dr. Munch? I immediately knew that he would like it. But what I discovered for myself was life-changing. I discovered that I had the power to forgive. No one could give me that power, and no one could take it away. Every single one of you here has that power. No one can give it to you, no one can take it away. You can use it in any way you wish. I began writing my letter of forgiveness. It took me 4 months. And at the end, I thought that looked pretty good, but then I was concerned about my spelling. And I thought if somebody read that letter, I would be embarrassed. So I called my former English professor to correct my spelling. We met 3 times. The 3rd time she said to me, now Eva, you know, it's very nice that you forgive Dr. Munch, but your problem is not with Dr. Munch. Your problem is with Dr. Mengele. I tried to debate the issue. She said, okay, when you go home tonight, pretend that you are talking to Mengele and telling him that you forgive him. Because what I want you to find out for yourself, how would it make you feel? It was an interesting idea. I got home, closed the bedroom door, picked up a dictionary, made a list of as many nasty words as I could find. I read them out loud, And at the end I said, in spite of all that, I forgive you. It was an interesting feeling that really my forgiveness will be the last relationship between me and Joseph Mengele. And there was nothing that he could change it. And that made me feel very powerful, that I even had power over the angel of death in Auschwitz. I wasn't hurting anybody, so why couldn't I do it? And if I forgave Mengele, the worst of the worst, I might as well forgive everybody who has ever hurt me. And I definitely have a long list of people who have hurt me. So this is the way we arrived in Auschwitz. Dr. Munch came with his son, daughter, and granddaughter. I took my son and my daughter. We stood by the ruins of the gas chamber, under the beam of the gas chamber. Dr. Munch signed his document. I read and signed mine. And I immediately felt that I was no longer a victim of Auschwitz. I was no longer a prisoner of my tragic past. I was free of Auschwitz and I was free of Mengele. My forgiveness is completely different than anything else I have seen. I am going to try to coin a better word for it, because it's an act of self-healing, self-liberation, self-empowerment, to discover that I had some power over my life. That was, to me, a great discovery. Up to that time, I always reacted to what other people did to me. This time, I was initiating action. And the rest of the world can react to it or not. It doesn't really affect them. I don't need anybody's permission, approval, or acceptance. It works. And actually, I want to tell you, I Google a lot, not Google a lot, tweet a lot. I Google a lot too. I use Google just about, I tweet a lot. And I started tweeting because I wanted to, in 140 characters, to tell. For instance, one of my tweets, forgiveness creates a feeling of wholeness in thought, spirit, and action, going in the same direction, creating a force for good. It's free. Everybody can afford it. It has no side effects. And if you do not like the way you feel free, you can always go and take your pain back. The other tweet I have, forgiveness is the best revenge. Because from the moment you forgive, those who harm you no longer have any influence or power over your life. And there are many of these things. I keep tweeting. And if you want to follow me, that would be very nice. So, and then you can add your ideas to it. But that is what I like to do. I also studied that, and the idea that anger, Hitler himself was a very angry guy. Anger is bad. It creates war. I don't think that happy people ever started wars. Wars are started by angry people. Therefore, I call anger a seed for war. Forgiveness. People who forgive are at peace with themselves and the world. So I call forgiveness a seed for peace. Now, when you leave here, if you, any of you, have problems with pain from the past, and I actually would like to declare that I believe that every human being has a human right to live without the pain of the past. Because the pain of the past does not help you be happier or a better person. So if you want to get rid of your pain and heal yourself, you will need a piece of paper and a pen. And you must write a letter until at the end you write the word, I forgive you, and you mean those words. Do not mail the letter to the people who hurt you. That relationship that was toxic might be still toxic. The forgiveness is for you. And if it makes you feel like you're Maria on the top of the hill singing Sound of Music, you feel that free and that liberated and that happy, pass it on to somebody else. Because I need all of your help to sow those seeds of peace throughout the world. Now, I will add you to that a home assignment. You didn't think I would do that. But just about 2 weeks ago, I watched a film about Darfur. The film was very difficult to watch. They had lots of people with accents worse than mine, and I had difficulty understanding their English. But I became aware of one thing that I didn't know, that the killing in Darfur is still going on. Al-Bashir is killing as many people, and the people who benefit from that is China. China is getting oil from Darfur, and they are selling armaments to Al-Bashir. And I am asking myself, here I am in this world, I go to bed at night pretty comfortably, I don't worry that people will harm me. I have a very important place in my life, a place called home. How many of you in this group have a place called home? Raise your hands. Do you value how important that thing is? Because I know how it feels without a home. What I would like you to do as an assignment, because I want to stop Bashir. I want to stop the killings there. I don't want anybody to get in any danger. I started some 8 years ago, 7 years ago, we put on our website a simple idea of children in school, as young as 6, 7, 8, research the genocide in Darfur and write letters. Because see, children are always the first victims in every tragedy, and they have no voice in what's happening. I would like to give voice to the children, but I want to give voice to everybody. And so we thought if we could collect 100,000 letters and flood the Chinese embassy or even China, I can see these bureaucrats digging through the letters, because they are not. The bureaucracy and the censorship, they would not. I would mail it to China. Actually, I would mail it to a government office. So I did go to the Chinese embassy to deliver my letters. We had 2,000. They mailed it back to us. So I don't know. What I am saying, I am only one brain, one mind. So your assignment is, if you can come up with something we can do without any of you getting hurt or doing anything that would harm you or anybody, that we could stop the killing in Darfur. Because it bothers me that I live in peace and there are people who are being murdered. Congratulations, you survived my lecture. Thank you very much. You can stand up.
Thank you very much. I think that if there are any questions, you are in charge. You decide if we should ask 3 or 4 questions.
Do you want to?
Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here tonight. I know we've all enjoyed that the Lord's given you wit. He's given you patience. He's given you much. I personally would have a very difficult time with forgiveness. I know the Lord's made me, and I have to pray beyond myself. Was there ever a time for the eternal that was able to make you forgive?
I know that religious people, Catholics, love me. The Jews, not so much. In Jewish religion, that's why I would like to remove forgiveness from any religion, because in my opinion, is a human need regardless of any religion. I arrived in Auschwitz as a very, very religious Jewish girl. I would not eat the bread that was given us the first night, even though I have not eaten anything in 4 days. Miriam and I looked at each other. This food was not kosher. Kosher is food prepared according to strict Jewish religious laws. But when I entered the latrine and saw the dead children on the floor, that religion completely disappeared. My coping mechanism said, do everything to survive. And that did not leave any room for my religious beliefs. Now, I don't want to tell anybody how they will cope when they will face this. And I never went back to religion. I believe that there is a God. I think he made a lot of boo-boos. Auschwitz, he was not in Auschwitz. And the first thing, if I go up to the pearly gates and there is such a thing, I would ask God for a debate. I want to know why in every tragedy, the innocent children are the first to get hurt. I do not understand that. That is the question. So, I don't understand how he works, but I will tell you one thing, that my forgiveness worked out so perfectly. That whole meeting with Dr. Munch, I never planned to forgive anybody. But the way that one thing after the other, it was not done by me. There was some kind of an intervention that I do not understand. So I believe that there is a God. How it works, or I also believe, for those of you who go to church and pray a lot, I believe that praying is for you, to make you a better person and a happier person. Praying never made me happy. So I think that doing the work I do is more important. And if I had a chance to ask God which one should I do, I think that he would probably choose on what I am doing. But that is just to, maybe it's an excuse, because I don't like to pray. I am not sure, but I'm using it, okay? Anything else I can tell you? All right. What is the first word?
Acceptance.
Acceptance and tolerance. I do not remember using that one. Yeah, I talked about, the lectures were a lot shorter, so I could talk about a lot. But I remember meeting with a reporter in 1984 at Purdue University, and he was just graduating from the School of Journalism, and the media has an opportunity. They take a picture of a survivor when we are crying and we look pathetic. And I was sobbing, and he said, Eva Kor is begging for tolerance. I was furious. I said, you young men do not know me. I have never begged for anything. even when I was hungry, I stole the food, and I... and I do not beg for tolerance, I demand respect. And there is a big deal, difference between respect and tolerance. And I wish that they would stop teaching tolerance, because what does the word tolerance mean? This is the word I have trouble with. Yeah, it's better than killing, but we all of us want to be respected. So why don't we teach respect instead of teaching tolerance? The word tolerance means putting up with you. That is not a word. I have words with problem with two words, justice and tolerance. Neither one of them make to me any sense. That people who are deprived of respect, that would be the highest level that they would want to go, is tolerance? No, it's a step toward respect, but I demand respect. The other thing is justice. What does justice mean? If you kill everybody who did something wrong, will that make the world just and loving? And the victims will not have anything left to worry about because the perpetrators have been murdered? It would not change, it would not have changed my life one iota if every Nazi was hanged. I still would have been an orphan at age 11 with nobody came back and still would have lived under communist regime starving to death. So I don't know if that would have helped me. On the other hand, if I could have talked to Mengele, I would have maybe known what he injected into me, into Miriam, and Miriam might be still alive. Okay, there is another life lesson that I used to share. And as I get these life lessons get long, you have them on your bookmarkers. You have quite a few on the bookmarkers. You can read them. One of the most difficult things that I had when I got back from the camp, that I never got any hugs and kisses from my parents again. And I tremendously miss that. So what I want you to do when you see your parents, I want you to value the fact, and I hope you have loving parents, that you have parents. Give your parents an extra hug and an extra kiss. For all of us children who had no parents to hug and kiss, and for children today who have no loving parents to hug and kiss. Okay, one more question. Yes. Well, if you follow me on Twitter, I want to show you something. I met with my executive director, brought to Terre Haute, I think it was last fall. He said he was going to have two Syrians come to tell about the Syrian refugee. So I wanted to be there because I was sure that they were going to blame all the problems on Israel, and I was going to stand up for Israel. Well, there were two Syrians, one Muslim and one Jewish. I didn't even know that they had Jews in Syria. That was news to me. And they talked for about an hour and a half, and I said, you know, that's enough talking. I want you to now tell me one thing I can do to help you, because I will help you. They said, we need to have safe zones in Syria. We don't need people to accept refugees. We need people to help us create a safe zone. So I tweeted. I tweeted, for instance, a nice tree. Okay, you hold. because I want to show those who are close by what I was tweeting. For some reason, that thing is not opening. All right. Okay, so let's see. Oh, the tweeting here, it's going to be. Because I took the tree, for instance, and I said, this reminds me of fall and the need to create a safe zone in Syria. Everything was, for the next 2 weeks, everything. And you know, they said it helped. I had to call Mohammed. I haven't been in touch with him for a while. Oh, why didn't that move anymore? Oh, it's just working. Well, here is another interesting little picture. I am at the Pacers game, and I was given a Heroes Award. And this guy is a former player. His name is Darnell Hillman, a star player, when my son Alex was a ball boy at the Pacers. Shorties. You two can be a star center court. That part. So those, you can hear this doll, and there I am with my walker walking in it. Then there I have a picture just recently. I cannot find that. It's not working here. The Twitter doesn't let me get back to that. But I was just in Miami and met with Ray Allen. He came to my lecture with his 5 children and wife. So I took a picture with him. Here I am. Let me turn it this way. Maybe it will be bigger. And then he tweeted the top of the book. And he said he read the book and he couldn't put it down. So I said, well, I need $6 million if you could sell 6 million books for $15 or whatever the price is. That's not that I can have the money for the museum, for the new museum. So anyway, but I am, it's not going any further. It would be nice. Oh, maybe it's moving now. No. It's stuck at Darnell Hillman. There is an other thing here. Here is the Nazi doctor. This is the picture that you have all seen last year. I did not grab and kiss him. I know that I am very huggable and lovable. I went up to him to take a picture. And I was shaking his hand. I wanted to thank him that he had the courage to validate the tragedy of the victims. And that was the only trial where a Nazi actually testified to the crime that he has committed. And I thought it took a lot of courage for him to do that. And there were about 60 survivors, 59 of them were accusing him. I told him what he did wrong, and I also told him that I forgive him. But my forgiveness does not absolve him for taking responsibility for his actions, which he has. So he grabs me, pulls me in, and gives me a hug and a kiss on my cheek. I was a little bit stunned, but I wasn't going to push him away. I realized, and I asked my attorney to take a picture of me. When he turned on the filming, and it was actually a little film clip of about maybe 15 seconds, but that went viral very fast. But it's not me. All the survivor says, how come you kiss Nazis and hug Nazis? And so that is their problem, not mine. I am at peace with who I am. I like who I am. And I am at peace with what I do. Okay. These answers are too long. And it's time to go home.
I'm sure everyone here had an absolutely wonderful time listening to Ms. Kor's stories about her personal experiences. Can we just give her one more round of applause?